Have you ever wondered what the numbers on a critically ill patient's monitor really mean? Among the various metrics, one in particular is often misunderstood and undervalued, the central venous pressure, or CVP. Many argue that CVP neither indicates blood volume nor fluid responsiveness, criticizing its usefulness. But, is that the full picture? Let's debunk some misconceptions and shed light on the true importance of this clinical parameter. CVP is much more than just a number. It provides an ongoing indication of the equilibrium between the return of venous blood and the heart's ability to handle it. In essence, it's a real-time gauge of how well your heart and blood vessels are communicating. When we measure pressures with fluid-filled systems, they're relative to a reference level. In cardiovascular physiology, this level is the midpoint of the right atrium, about 5 centimeters below the sternal angle. The CVP, even at peak exercise, only rises to about 4 millimeters of mercury and is in a similar range when supine. But here's where things get interesting. The heart is surrounded by pleural pressure, whereas the body is at atmospheric pressure. When we evaluate preload and cardiac function, what really matters is the difference between the CVP relative to the atmosphere and the PPL. This difference is known as the transmural pressure. Now, let's delve into the impact of high CVP values on patient outcomes. Research shows a correlation between decreased survival of critically ill patients and elevated CVP. For instance, a reanalysis of the VASST trial found a mortality rate 35% lower in patients with a CVP under 8 mm of mercury during shock, as compared to those with a CVP above 8 mm of mercury. Similarly, patients who had a CVP greater than 10 mm of mercury for longer periods showed worse outcomes. Now, let's take a look at the kidneys. Elevated CVP values have been associated with an increased risk of acute kidney injury in critically ill patients. In fact, raising venous pressure in isolated animal kidneys has been shown to decrease urine output, and even stop it at CVP greater than 25 mm of mercury. The proposed mechanism here is renal tamponade, caused by increased interstitial pressure within the kidney's capsule. In patients with cardiovascular disease, a CVP greater than 6 mm of mercury was associated with worsening renal function and decreased survival. Interestingly, an acute rise in CVP proved to be more impactful than a chronic increase. In one retrospective study of critically ill patients, a 1 cmH2O increase in CVP above 7 cmH2O upon admission was linked to a 2% higher risk of acute kidney injury. Early elevated CVP following cardiac surgery also stood out as a significant determinant of kidney injury. But, it's not just the kidneys. An elevated CVP is also associated with liver injury and failure. Researchers have found that elevation of bilirubin, a marker of liver disease, was related to elevations of CVP but not to cardiac output. In animal studies, an increase in CVP directly bumped up portal venous pressure and reduced the flow through portal veins and hepatic arteries. This gives us a clear indication of a mechanistic process. You might be wondering, how does an elevated CVP cause organ damage? Well, let's get into some simple biophysics. The balance of fluid filtration in the microcirculation is determined by two main forces: the force pushing fluid out of the vessel, which is the hydrostatic pressure, and the force keeping fluid in, that's the intravascular oncotic pressure. Now, when the CVP increases, it directly raises the capillary hydrostatic pressure, assuming no change in venous resistances. But here's where things get problematic. In critically ill patients, albumin, which is the main determinant of oncotic pressure, often reduces. This imbalance means that a CVP greater than 10 mm of mercury will likely disrupt the filtration balance in the capillaries and cause tissue edema. Inflammatory conditions, like sepsis or trauma, further complicate this by increasing capillary permeability. The fluid filtered from the capillaries into the interstitial space normally drains back to the central veins via the lymphatic system. But an elevated CVP can also hinder this process. The impact of elevated CVP can be much more severe in encapsulated organs. This is because the increased volume of the organ parenchyma can tamponade the blood flow, causing structures such as the urinary tubules, hepatic sinusoids, and venules to collapse. Another important aspect to consider is the changes in intrathoracic pressure, induced by mechanical ventilation. Keep in mind, the CVP value crucial for venous return is the value relative to the atmosphere, and not transmural pressure. Ideally, the right heart works to keep CVP as close to zero as possible. Here's an interesting contrast. While in spontaneous breathing, pleural pressure decreases during inspiration. However, during passive mechanical ventilation, pleural pressure increases. In fact, the use of positive end expiratory pressure, or PEEP, always results in a positive PPL. In response to a decreased transmural pressure, the body attempts to compensate by retaining sodium and water. The resultant increases in CVP are transmitted to the portal veins, potentially causing jaundice and liver swelling. So, positive pressure ventilation always creates a sort of conflict. On one hand, a higher CVP is required to maintain preload or transmural pressure, but on the other hand, there's a need to prevent organ congestion and damage. While a decrease in transmural pressure could be addressed by increasing inotropy, decreasing right ventricular afterload, or increasing heart rate, options to reduce tissue congestion are limited, mostly involving lowering venous pressure. In fact, an animal study showed that fluid accumulation was directly related to mechanical ventilation and was further increased by adding PEEP. A positive fluid balance in mechanically ventilated patients was also associated with higher mortality. And for patients with acute respiratory distress syndrome, survivors tended to have much smaller daily fluid balances than non-survivors. Here's another crucial point. Applying PEEP requires higher systemic venous pressures to maintain cardiac output. So, if CVP starts high, the tissue consequences can be severe and may even hinder the weaning process. To wrap things up, let's revisit the main takeaways from our discussion on central venous pressure or CVP. Remember, CVP is usually low. When CVP values are higher than normal, they proportionally increase the risk of systemic tissue edema. So, increases in CVP come with a cost, and these costs must be weighed against benefits. When CVP is elevated, potential strategies such as keeping tidal volumes and airway pressures lower, and/or using inotropes, should be considered, especially when there's increased capillary permeability. It's important to note that an emphasis on fluid responsiveness may have diverted attention from the potential harm caused by a high CVP. CVP, along with its change over time, are critical safety parameters to monitor. It's not just about the current state, but the ongoing evolution and overall trend. And with that, we've come to the end of our exploration of central venous pressure. I hope you found it informative and helpful. Don't forget to like this video, share it with your colleagues, and subscribe to our channel for more insightful content. Thank you for watching, and until next time, stay curious, keep learning.